Sometime during the week of April 23rd, I put on a green armband. Several weeks after the police bust, I joined the staff of the Project of Columbia Structure, the student faculty research arm of the Executive Committee of the Faculty. The project, directed by Columbia Law School Professor Frank Gray, recruited about 15 students from several Columbia divisions. I spent the summer of 1968 attending staff and committee meetings, discussing the university's past and future relationships with its students, faculty, and the surrounding community, and writing about university governance. The project, and later the Senate, was at least a crucible for campus leadership for some of us. The project's September 68 report signaled the direction later taken by the executive committee. Academic government has failed to keep up with contemporary needs and expectations, the report stated, and has been largely unresponsive, not only at Columbia, but at universities generally, both to the desires of faculty and students to play a role in the shaping of the university's policies and social goals, and to the need of defining the relationship to the society of which it is a part. Significant change in governance, we knew, was coming to Columbia, and we saw research as a way of helping that process along. The project continued into the 68-69 academic year. The project produced about 20 reports that related directly to the work of the executive committee, or by Bill Villian's 162-page report on the university's questionable community relations and housing project and housing policies, and Mark Weiss's report on junior faculty at Columbia that later enabled Senate committees to define agendas and to act on concrete data. My report on methods of trustee selection argued that board self-perpetuation was not incompatible with Senate participation in the selection process. The final Senate proposal included a significant consultative role for the Senate in trustee selection. I suspect that informal discussions among students and faculty on the project staff and members of the executive committee were equally or even more influential than on formal reports. Frank Grad attended most executive committee meetings, and its minutes show that his comments to the committee were consistent with the staff consensus on most issues. At the same time, Frank often guided us toward a more nuanced understanding of how universities work. Few staff members supported a bicameral governance structure that separated students from faculty. You know how I stood. The executive committee opted for the unicameral body by fall 69, and its minutes quote one member as saying, students do not want an isolated Mickey Mouse play legislature of their own, or it'd be easy to develop adversary attitudes. But collectively, the staff did not see itself as an independent political force. It took no formal collective positions on Senate proposals. In contrast, many other student organizations had much to say, but finding common ground among all students proved difficult. Mark Weiss recalls that the two of us worked all night to prepare a criterion covering many technicalities of the draft proposal for a Senate issued in February 1969. Focusing on the composition of the Senate and its committees, eligibility for Senate seats and for places on committees, representation of constituencies, and Senate and committee powers, we knew that the rules of the game helped to determine substantive outcomes, and that all university constituencies therefore expected the Senate bylaws to be fair. To those who could read between the lines of our report, the message was that the tenured faculty and the administration would have to give just a little more. Project members were impressed by the proposed Senate bylaw giving the Senate broad legislative powers. The list of enumerated powers did not limit the Senate from considering, here's a quotation from the bylaws, all matters of university-wide concern, all matters affecting more than one faculty or school, and all matters pertaining to the implementation and execution of agreements with other educational institutions that are now or may hereafter become affiliated with the university. This was Frank Grad's position from the outset. I'm not sure he needed any blitzing from the student staff members, but he got some anyway. But he and the staff knew that having broad powers did not compel their use. A while later, having run out of fellowship funds, but with a thesis to complete, I accepted a position on the Senate staff. So let me add a few comments on the Senate's inner workings from a staff perspective. A 1972 report for the Committee on Structure and Operations noted that the Senate usually upheld the key decisions made in this committee. The reason, I think, is that at least one and respected and savvy member, usually from the faculty, though not all, and not always the committee chair, helped to assure the wisdom of proposals and reports. Each committee had a personality. Some committees worked by consensus with few formal votes. The rules of the meetings of the Committee on Rules of University Conduct, in contrast, were formal with many votes taken. Not surprising, given the key role that disciplinary procedures and due process played in the events leading to April 23, 1968, and given that two of the major protagonists on the committee were lawyers. The specifics are less important than understanding that by the late 1960s, in loco parentis was dead, but that a replacement philosophy of student for college relations proved difficult to find, and not only at Columbia. Most senators rose above the roles that Cambridge Dodd and Francis MacDonald Cornford defined in Microcosmographia Academica, subtitled Being a Guide for the Young Academic Politician. Rarely did, if ever, did senators rely on Cornford's principle of the wedge, that you should not act justly now for fear of raising expectations that you may act still more justly in the future. Expectations which you are afraid you will never have the courage to satisfy. There were times, the times were not ripe for a senator to invoke the principle of the dangerous precedent, that you should not now do an admittedly right action for fear that you or your equally timid successors should not have the courage to do right in some future case, which is essentially different but superficially resembles the present one. Every public action which is not customary, Cornford added, is either wrong or, if it is right, is a dangerous precedent. It follows, he concluded, that nothing should ever be done for the first time. Only a few committees engaged in comma hunting, a sport, Cornford noted, that wastes unlimited time. One starter comma hunt and the whole pack will be off. Full cry, especially if they have literary training. Critics at the time often charged that university faculty had abandoned their institutional obligations in favor of professional and disciplinary recognition. Worse, so the indictment went, they guided their students in the same direction. But the faculty members who served on the Project for Columbia Structure, the Executive Committee of the Senate, and the Senate itself and its committees refuted that charge. Many of Columbia's best known and respected faculty members invested much time and energy in healing a deeply wounded university. We students learned that lesson well. I spent the past 35 years teaching courses on higher education administration and still apply the key lesson learned during my year on the project Faculty, staff, and students have an institutional stake equal to trustees and administrators, and therefore must retain a voice in campus affairs, and not only during crises. In turn, those constituencies have a responsibility to serve and to accept that responsibility with the same dedication and commitment we give to our teaching and research. I take pride in the small part I played in helping the project and the executive committee through the project design and implement the governance mechanism that the president could consult at tense moments, that created informal connections across a university divided into many fiefdoms and vassalages, and that kept a careful eye on the administration, as Walter Metzger emphasized in an early speech to the Senate, while becoming the university's arena for resolving important disputes, for channeling potential crises into productive directions, and occasionally, maybe only occasionally, as Robert Kennedy famously said, for turning problems into opportunities. Thank you.